Shit. Shit.
Going past these houses.
Okay, no worries.
Very slow.
All right.
George, that's you.
That's right, Jenny. Yep, it is.
What's it like watching that?
It's quite strange. It's like third person. It's not like I'm watching myself. It's like I'm watching someone else.
Do you remember how you felt as you were doing the drive?
Yeah, obviously, that was a harrowing experience for me. It was something like out of Mad Max. That's the first thing I thought of when, as I come through that, past that house that just burnt down, I watched it burnt down 10 minutes flat. Well, I sat on the side of the road and watched that house burn, and the police come along and said, hey, look, it's okay to go. Mm.
Did you know about the fire when you set out from Clare to Adelaide? Because you do that trip a lot.
I do that trip a lot, yeah. I travel that road at least once every 2 weeks. You know, I woke up that morning, the wind was pretty blustery. I looked out my backyard and my outside chairs got blown over, and I thought it was pretty warm. And I knew, living in the country, that it was catastrophic conditions for fires.
Did you know there was a fire that close, though?
No, didn't know.
Not no idea.
It wasn't until I was into the drive, probably 45 minutes or so, and then I saw the smoke and I thought, geez, that looks like a big fire.
Did you think you were gone for? Was there a point where you really panicked?
No, look, I didn't have time to stop and think. I was just like, wowee. So I just was thinking on the run.
Why did you keep driving? Was there a point where you thought about stopping or turning round or...?
No, there wasn't. Not at all. I had a schedule that day. I was tunnel vision. I was like, I had some parts to pick up. I've got a.
So you had work to do.
Had work to do.
So fire or no fire, you were just going to keep going no matter what.
As you saw, Templars, the cars there, the roadblocks. I think, oh yeah, that's pretty major. That's amazing. So I kept driving. And I saw the fire front, and I thought, oh yeah, that's cool. I'm thinking, Adelaide. I'm going to Adelaide. I've got to get to Adelaide. Right, I'm going to Adelaide. And then I just drove through it. I didn't stop to think about the danger or how dangerous it was or whether I was in danger. Look, the cars were still coming the other way. I mean, look, at the end of the day, that fire had been burning for a couple of hours, right?
Had you been in a bushfire before?
No.
What surprised you about it?
Oh, OK. You hear this story about fires, a firestorm, and I just assumed a fire was just a huge fire, massive flames. That's about all I thought. But when I hit the fire front, it was threefold. So what I realised afterwards, that a firestorm is more than just a great big fire, is the flames actually suck in the air around it and creates its own storm, its own vortex of flames and stuff.
Mm. Tim, you're from Tasmania. You took this photo of your wife and grandchildren 3 years ago. Tell us where they are and why.
Oh, well, that's the jetty just down at the end of our property. And on that day, a firestorm had come through, and we sought refuge in the water. So we were there to preserve our lives and shelter from the firestorm.
The photo was taken in the afternoon. Let's go back to the morning. Mm-hmm. Were you aware of the danger in the morning?
We were very conscious that it was a high fire danger day, and we also knew that there was a fire burning some 15 kilometres away. We did know that there was a forecast for the winds to intensify during the day, and so we were aware that the fire could come in our direction.
What did you do to prepare?
All the things that I understood were necessary to give ourselves the best chance. Made sure all the gutters were cleared out, filled the gutters with water, cleared away any kind of combustible material from anywhere remotely close to buildings. We felt that we were ready to deal with the fire if it turned that up, the wind pushed it in our direction.
Did you think about leaving?
At that stage, no. Because we felt that because we've got the water all around, our property's like a point that juts out into the bay. I thought the safest thing to do in the event of the fire coming onto our property was to retreat to the water.
And you had the grandchildren with you for the day?
Yeah, for the day.
Mm.
Yeah.
Tammy, how prepared were you for what happened that day?
Well, first thing in the morning, you know, we were obviously aware that there was a fire. I don't think I really prepared myself greatly. I mean, you know, Tim was out doing everything that needed to be done outside. I had the children, so I just made sure that I was with them, doing things with them, keeping calm. We had the radio on so we could listen.
So when did you decide to leave the house with the children and head to the water?
I had all the children sitting on the table and I was preparing lunch for them, and all of them had their backs to the window. And as I looked up, ready to hand them some food, I saw over their heads the fire caught the house across the hill. And straight away I knew. I thought, this is really serious. And I just said, come on, let's take our picnic down to the water. Let's go down to the jetty. And we go to the jetty quite a bit. You know, I go crabbing with the children and we have fun together down by the water. So I just...
What were you feeling like inside at that point?
This is serious. Mm. Thinking, oh gosh, this is really serious.
But trying to stay calm for the kids.
I stay very calm, very calm.
And you went straight into the water?
We went to the fence line and then followed the fence line down towards the water.
Mm.
Yeah.
Tim, you stayed behind for a while to try to protect the house. When did you decide it was time to go and join them at the jetty?
That was a very decisive moment. After Tammy had gone and I was sort of there on my own thinking, well, I'll still do my best to protect the property, three fire brigade trucks came up the driveway and I just thought, oh, this is brilliant. I've got a chance now.
Saviours.
Yeah, exactly. Mm. Knights in shining armour. Anyway, the small fire trucks came to a halt nearby to our house and the fire captain came out and we talked for a moment, and we were standing on the front lawn, and the wind was very strong and gusty, and as we stood there, a column of flame came through the air like something completely unreal. You just would never imagine it. It was almost like a tornado of just flame. The ground wasn't burning, the trees weren't burning, it was just gas burning in the air.
What, just like a twister?
Like a twister, and it was massive. And
like a flame twister?
Yes, that's correct. And it passed directly in front of us. And I don't know if we said anything to each other, but we both knew this is not fightable.
Justin, you're a fire scientist with the CSIRO. What causes that twister effect of flame and that idea of a huge hand of fire surrounding a building? I mean, when you hear that description, what's actually causing it?
A fire is just an incredible heat source. So it's pushing up and then the winds come around and wrap around it and create these, you know, crazy and unpredictable winds that have flame drawn into them.
Do you think people have any idea what it's like before they're in one?
I think it's not something that it could be easily described. And of course, every fire is different as well. And the oppressive sound and wind, heat...
What's the sound like?
Loss of light. It's sort of, people describe it like as a jet engine. Like, it's just an insanely strong, overwhelming noise.
Was that what it was like, Tim?
Fronts wear up.
Mm. Yeah.
And I guess the smoke plumes can be so tall, they can just completely block out the sun and turn day into night.
Mm. Therese, you've been caught in two bushfires in South Australia. What really surprised you?
I guess the second time round, I couldn't believe I was doing the same silly things again.
What sort of silly things?
Just finding myself in the wrong place at the wrong time for the second time. I thought I would have learnt more from my first experience. They were 4 years apart. Up to that point, whenever I heard that tomorrow was going to be a hot day, all I ever thought about was, great, let's go to the beach. I never had any interest, appreciation, awareness or anything of bushfires. I was extremely naive, ignorant even.
What surprised you, though, about the actual being in one? What were the things you didn't expect?
At one point, everything almost went silent, like there was a lack of sound, almost like a void, as if someone had pressed the mute button. And then I thought someone had laid a train track down my road and a train was coming. Sorry.
You okay?
Yeah, I'm fine. A jet engine is another, I guess, comparison, but I've never been close enough to an engine, but I have been close enough to a train. So the sounds are magnified. Everything's magnified.
What about breathing?
I remember at one point leaving our home. We're surrounded by water, a little bit like Tim and Tammy, and we eventually left the beach in our tinny. With people in the boat, and I was remembering having to lean down on the lee side of the boat to get a breath of air so that I could stand up to have enough energy to push the boat, and I was having to do that with each step. And it was like, not that I've ever done it, but it would be like sucking on the end of a hairdryer. Like, as soon as you breathed in, your whole mouth and your throat was so dry. So then it makes breathing difficult. It makes talking difficult, and I guess then dehydration sets in really quickly.
Tammy, what did you and the kids do once you got to the jetty?
When we first got to the jetty, I asked Matilda and the three younger ones to head to the jetty and then head into the water. They started to go onto the jetty, and I said, no, I think you better stay in the water, just walk into the water a little bit. And as I got into the water with the children, the smoke was coming down very thickly, and so we went deeper and deeper.
How much could you see at that stage?
Probably only a few metres in front of me.
How were the kids?
They handled it really well. They were amazing, absolutely amazing. I was really proud of them.
Even the little ones?
Yeah, yeah. In fact, the little ones didn't show any fear. We had a few laughs, you know, they... Charlotte, who is not quite two, is quite a funny little one anyway, and she came up with all sorts of things, and she'd just have a chuckle and laugh at something and we'd all laugh.
Could they swim? Could they all swim?
The three older ones could swim, yeah, but we were hoping we didn't have to do that. Mm.
And what about your dog, Polly?
Polly.
It's a children's dog, actually.
Yeah, it was a Springer Spaniel. Belonged to the Walker children, and she absolutely loved the children. And as we were fleeing and running down the hill, Liam said, my dog. And I said, I'm sorry, you can't go back for the dog. And then Matilda said, my chickens. And then someone said, the rabbits, the budgerigar. And I said, I'm sorry, we just need to save ourselves. We need to get down to the water. And just at that point, Polly came running behind us. She'd either heard us or she was aware of something and came running, sniffing the ground, looking for us.
So she stayed on the jetty?
Yeah, she did.
Yeah, because treading water for a dog for 2 hours would be
I was very
impossible.
Grateful. I didn't even think about it, but as we went into the water, she went onto the jetty, and just as we were going out deeper, she stayed on the jetty just walking out with us. And at one point she laid down on the jetty with her head right down to try and breathe. So she was a smart dog. Mm. Yeah.
Tim, what was it like trying to get to Tammy at the jetty and the kids?
Oh, well, because I'd left it a few minutes later before I departed from the house, the bushfire had kind of progressed very, very rapidly, and it wasn't only coming from the northwest, it seemed to be coming from the west and the southwest. And so just about everything seemed to be on fire, even as I ran, and I did run. And over that 400 metres, it was incredible how quickly the fire took hold of everything.
Could you see where you were going?
That was the biggest problem. The smoke was so thick and black, and I couldn't see a thing. In fact, I just ran on instinct, knowing that if I kept running downhill, I'd eventually hit the water.
What did you do when you got there?
Oh, well, I was very thankful to see Tammy and the children in the water, and we probably sort of considered our circumstances, decided that we were in the best place we could be, that we didn't have much choice, actually, that we couldn't have gone anywhere else.
Mm. And the jetty caught fire at one stage.
Oh, yes, it
did. How did you deal with that?
Well, everything was on fire. The boat shed was burning, the trees were burning, trees were falling, birds were dropping out of the sky and splashing around about us. And, yes.
And the kids were still okay through all this?
Yes. Yeah, we were keeping them calm. Tammy in particular was sort of talking with them and reassuring them that we were going to be okay.
I couldn't understand why a program like this wasn't compulsory.
There's no national system that you can just go bang, that's where I live, that's my bushfire risk.
No, that's completely true.
Therese, when the first fire swept by your home near Port Lincoln in 2001, you headed for the water, as you said. Did you have any kind of bushfire plan?
No, nothing, zero, zilch.
So
not
what?
At all.
So what did you do to prepare?
Very little, indeed. I went outside and placed anything that could hold water outside the front of our house. I tied some gates open so that people could find their way in and got some clothes that I thought would be sensible to wear in a fire, like long pants, hats, boots. But the unsafe thing that I did was I deliberately took them out and put them in the containers of water so that they'd be nice and wet, ready to put on when the fire came, because I thought that that would be a really safe thing to do.
And why wasn't it a safe thing to do?
Because radiant heat turns water to steam. So you should never, ever, ever wear wet clothes in a bushfire.
Is that right, Justin?
Yeah, that's generally true. Your clothes, when they're dry, are more insulating than when they're wet. So certainly use water to recover, but if the threat of fire is coming, dry clothes.
And you headed to the water?
Yes, we...
To escape by boat, and obviously you were the one pushing the boat out.
Yes, we popped the dog and the photo albums and our friends in the boat and escaped out to try and get out from the smoke, because it was just too hot to breathe. You couldn't see anything, so there was no point in staying.
And when the fire was over, mm-hmm. and you were okay, mm-hmm. and your house was okay?
Yes, yes.
And once you absorbed everything that had gone on, what were you determined you were going to do as a result of this fire?
About 12 months later, I was invited by the CFS, which is a rural volunteer fire service in South Australia, to go and speak to two groups of people who were considering starting a program that we run in South Australia called Community Fire Safe. What I learnt about the Community Fire Safe program over those two visits, talking to residents who were preparing for bushfires, I couldn't understand why a program like this wasn't compulsory. I learnt so much from that program, and I just thought that everybody who lives in a bushfire prone area should be made to do this. It's just invaluable information. I liken it a little bit to, like, if you have a swimming pool, you have to have it fenced, you know, you do first aid, you learn CPR. If you live in a bushfire prone area, or basically three quarters of Australia, why doesn't everybody have to do this and learn about bushfires?
So did you have a plan by the time the second fire hit, 4 years later?
No, I didn't, Jenny.
So you'd been, talked to the people, got all the information, no fire plan?
No, still none. Like I said,
why do you think that was? Well, I mean, this is really interesting, because you'd not only been through the fire, but you'd had all the information given to you.
I guess priorities and life and things just got in the way. I suppose I'm of the generation now that if my car breaks down, I ring a mechanic. If I've got a toothache, I ring a dentist. If there's a bushfire, you ring the fire service. I'd never thought that I would actually have to fix my own car or do my own dental work or fight my own bushfire.
So you thought the fireys would save you?
Yeah.
A bit like you, Tim, when the fireys arrived, thinking, right, it's all sorted now, they're here.
Yeah.
John, do you know how many people have bushfire plans?
It would be less than 10% in most communities, even in high-risk areas. Very few people have a written plan or have thought much about it at all.
Mm. You've been a firefighter yourself for 30 years.
That's right.
And you're with Emergency Management Victoria. When you hear these stories, I mean, how common are they and how common are the responses?
Pretty common. I'm not surprised by the stories I've heard tonight. One of the issues for Australians generally is we've spent the last century retreating from the bush, and so our learned knowledge about bushfire is not what it used to be. It's no longer something that we deal with routinely. We don't think that much about the weather. A lot of people move from an air-conditioned house to an air-conditioned car to an air-conditioned workplace. And so
we're dealing with them more, though, bushfires.
Absolutely, absolutely. You know, the number of fires and the severity of those fires is increasing every year. And so whereas 30 years ago when I started as a firefighter, you wouldn't expect a big fire more than once every decade. Now that gap between the next big fire and the one that's just gone is increasingly smaller, so 2, 3, 4 years.
Therese, you now work for the Country Fire Service in South Australia, so clearly you did get motivated eventually. The second fire kicked you into action. Given that fires have been through your area, are people interested afterwards in planning, in getting involved, or do they do what you did, which is life just gets in the way and they go on?
After fires is usually when we have a really high attendance, which is unfortunate because you're already preaching to the converted by then. But there certainly has been a gradual increase in the uptake of the information that we provide. We talk to them about their options of staying or going, and preparing their house is obviously preferred to be a non-negotiable, because regardless of what you want to do, it's nice to... your best chance of surviving is if your house is well prepared. And then hopefully by the end of the sessions that we run, people have a written and then a practiced bushfire survival plan.
OK, John.
When we talk about plans, it's a bit about planning before there's a fire, during the fire and after the fire. So that the gathering together of possessions, the gathering together of your jewellery and your passport and insurance document, you do that before the fire season. And you take all that stuff and you take it off to somewhere that's not going to be affected by the fire. So you can generally find the really important things in your life. You can compress into 3 cardboard boxes. Photos, a bit of jewellery.
Apart from the people you love who don't see the cardboard boxes. But yeah, go on.
So the possessions is easy to deal with. And then it's about your own safety, and that's the during. And so a checklist is a great idea. There's an essential decision here about staying or going, and you have to make a decision about that.
Why wouldn't everyone just go?
Yeah,
that might seem like a very naive question, but...
We encourage everyone to go, particularly on high-risk days, but what happens is that people wait and see. And so, you know, the leaving early means leaving before a fire's even started, before anything's happened, and to get people to do that is actually quite hard because it's very disruptive to their lives. And
fires can behave very unpredictably too,
of course,
can't they?
Of course. And so you need a plan A and a plan B and probably a plan C.
Mm-hmm. Alan, you're an urban planner. What about people who say, I've been through one bushfire, I can defend the house again if I need to, my garden was fine, you know?
Mm. Well, I guess there's two sort of main things that can change that immediately come to mind. The people can be the same people but older, or maybe they're infirm and they weren't in the last fire. I guess the other thing that can change is the house, the garden, the house next door, the level of fuel management in the area.
John, you said you encourage people to go, to leave their properties. If they do decide to stay and defend, what should they do?
The first thing is exactly that about, are you physically and mentally capable of defending your home? You won't be able to do it by yourself, so you'll need to have at least 2 people doing it. There's a whole lot of preparatory things. You'll need water, you'll need some equipment. You'll need to have a house that's prepared so that's as ember-proof as possible.
Justin, what are the most common mistakes people make when they decide to defend their houses?
They sort of retreat to a place in the house that feels relatively safe, something like a bathroom. And that's sort of shown time and time again to be one of the worst strategies, because you've isolated yourself from knowledge of whether the fire's passed, whether the house has started to burn, and what your prospects are of potentially leaving that house if it becomes unsafe.
So it's the worst place to go.
Yeah.
And there are statistics that show that people are more likely to die if they go, if they go into the particular room.
Yeah, so in fact, most people that have died in house fires, in bushfires, have died in bathrooms and in areas where there's one exit to the rest of the house, not an exit to the outside.
Mm. And are people more likely to die if they stay and defend their houses or if they flee? Like, if you've got a fire on top of you, do we know what's safer to you know, try and seek shelter or to try and get away?
Well, I guess what's in the past, about 30% of the people have died in their house. Another 30% have died within 50 metres of their house, so just outside their house. And about 10% of people have died in their cars. Not a long way away from the house.
Tim, would you stay and defend your house again if there was a fire?
I think
because your house survived. Yeah. Your house didn't survive, but you've rebuilt.
Yeah.
Would you stay and defend the new house?
I think the thing that you tried to do, or the thing that I tried to do, is to assess the magnitude of the fire. If I thought it was going to be a firestorm such as we experienced, no. If I had any notion that that was what was going to befall us, we would have left a long time in advance. Mm.
Tammy, what would you do?
Leave.
Any kind of fire?
Certainly if I didn't have the grandchildren, I would stay with Tim and do our best to fight. But I wouldn't put myself through a firestorm, or certainly wouldn't like to put my grandchildren through that again. Mm.
You're still living on the same block
yeah.
in Tasmania. Let's have a look at what you've done since the fire.
Where we're standing now was actually the front lawn, and Tammy's very keen on her garden, so we had lovely gardens and a fence and lots of flowers in this area here. We knew almost intuitively that we would stay here.
We're doing our best to plant fire-resistant plants, have non-flammable materials around the house. And pick some beans for our dinner, shall we? Because we like more rustic, artistic timber things, obviously we have to balance it a bit.
This time we've got an irrigation system buried underground, and that was one of the first things we did. So we've got a row of taps all around here, and then a row of taps further out. It takes water all around the property, around the perimeter, and then close around the building. Before, we just had the odd garden tap.
We live in a dry coastal area. Things that naturally grow here just seem to burn very easily. We've gone more for deciduous and evergreens and more fire-resistant plants.
Well, we made a point of putting sandstone paving around the building. So even though there is a little bit of exposed timber, if fire comes up against this with the taps and sprinklers, we should be able to protect this okay. We removed the combustible material that was fairly straightforward. To have taken all the timber windows out and replaced them with steel or aluminium was prohibitive. On the house that we had before, we had a timber deck around it, and I suspect that the deck would have caught fire and everything else would have followed pretty quickly. We've got a far better knowledge of knowing how to reduce the risks. Life is a risk, isn't it? There's risks everywhere.
Do you think those things would make a difference if you were faced with the same situation again?
We're better prepared now. We've certainly taken measures that would reduce the likelihood of our buildings catching fire.
Mm. What other things?
Gutter guards, using materials that outbuilding is actually rammed earth, so that's not going to burn.
So if you were faced with that same situation again, do you think that you'd have a much better chance of surviving, or do you think it would be the same?
No, I think that previous situation was beyond our ability to defend ourselves.
Justin, will those sorts of things make a difference? Do they make a substantial difference to your chances?
I think will make a massive life risk improvement to the scenario. And I guess if it comes down to sort of determining whether your house is far less likely to burn down, it really comes down to the little details of what you've used around your eave linings and how you've sealed up all the little gaps and what type of timbers you've used in your windows.
So it's so those things really, really matter? Like, they make a big difference?
They are. The fire really looks for the weakest link it can find, and it will burn it down for the smallest reason. Once the fire takes hold in a building cavity or inside the house, it will burn the house down completely.
Kate, you head up the Bushfire Building Council of Australia. How do people know if they're in a bushfire zone in Australia?
So states have different ways of doing it, but there's either statewide mapping that shows bushfire-prone areas. So you can put your address in and it'll say, yes, you're in or no, you're not. So it doesn't give you a level of risk. It's just yes or no. And if you want to find out what your level of risk is, then you need to go through a BAL assessment process.
A BAL assessment process, which BAL stands for Bushfire Attack Level.
Yes.
Justin, how easy is it to find out whether your house is in a bushfire-prone area in Australia?
Well, there's no automatic thing to say yes or no, so you actually have to actively seek it out. Every state has a different system, so I guess you've got to start door knocking, ask your neighbours, ask the local fire authority.
So there's no system. We're facing bushfires, you know, most summers, and we've got 40% more of them in a five-year period that we've just found out about. There's no national system that you can just go, bang, that's where I live, that's my bushfire risk.
No, that's completely true.
Simon, you were recently built in St Helena on the urban fringe of Melbourne.
Yes.
You've embraced the building fire standards totally. Why?
It's not a primary reason. There's a few reasons. So I've got a very energy efficient home. Fire standards were a subset of the reasons, but energy efficiency, different construction, and wanted to invest in the future house for my young family.
Marcus, you built the house. Now, you set up your company after the Black Saturday fires.
Yes, so we, Refuge Homes, we started that in 2009 with the intention of finding a building system that actually is driven around the fire rating of a home.
What makes Simon's house different to the other houses in the street?
Oh, our home's a fully integrated concrete system, slab walls, roof, eaves, fascias, all concrete. So there's no convection through the eaves, there's no materials that'll burn on the outside.
Simon, do you think your house is fireproof?
Hearing the stories tonight, probably not.
Did you think it was before tonight?
No, I think it's safer. Would I sit there in a firestorm? Well, I don't think so. I certainly think it's built to a higher level of construction.
Is there any evidence that houses built to these standards survive better than other houses?
Yeah, so not that many houses that have been built to these new standards have been impacted by fires, but the 50-odd that have tended to survive four times more likely to survive than ones that haven't.
We live in a country that need fire, and what's happened is that we've stopped evolving with fire.
As you can see, it's mixed tree country here. And as you can see, all the little trees have survived the slow burn. And the temperature in here is real, real cool. There's no hot flaming heat in here. And because it's nice and cool in here, it's real good for the vegetation and the trees too.
Victor, that's not what people expect to see with a bushfire. It looks very calm, and your colleague there is talking about it being cool near the flames. Well, what does he mean?
Well, that fellow there, Jason, he's a Gadigal
ranger in Bundaberg. And basically what he was doing there was a fire workshop and teaching him. And what I do, I go around and work with different communities, not just Indigenous, but also rural and fires and also pastoralists and residents as well.
What do you do? People. How is what you do different to the way the rest of the firefighting
community
different. Operates?
It's totally opposite to what everyone's doing here. Everyone's talking about the aftermath, and it's always the way Western, society works is really based on the aftermath of things and always acting when things are too late. Whereas all the work that I do is in the prevention of that. And it's really about putting fires in, not to save your house, just your house, but to save the bushlands, look after the environment as a whole, and above all, teach people what they should know about the country in terms of understanding fire properly.
When you light a fire, how is that fire different to, say, traditional backburning?
Firstly, the biggest problem in this country is that everyone's confused. And that's been done by different groups. Some people would go, we call this a fire for hazard reduction. And then they'll say, this is a fire for biodiversity. This is a fire for traditional burning that Indigenous people do. When in fact, there's only one fire, and that is the right fire. And fire for your country, your environment, and a fire that is there more frequently. And what I do with the burns that I do, I teach people in their own regions to read the country, understand the land, and be able to see the indicators and the signs on how to manage the country so we prevent wildfires.
Explain to us what fire circles are.
When we light fires, we just don't light fires anywhere. When I teach someone about burning the land, we'll go to the ignition point on that country, and there's a lot of reasons why that ignition point's there. And we burn out, and so the fire burns like a circle outwards. And when it does that, it's a single point, and the fire goes in a 360 degrees radius. Everything can smell that smoke, and everything can escape from that 360 degrees.
So it Nothing protects the trapped. Animals and the...
That's right. Mm. That is the primary thing that we need to be doing, is protecting the environment, because we can't keep doing what we're doing. We can't continue to sit back and watch hundreds of kilometres of land being annihilated and yet just sit down and just think about ourselves. But in due respect, we need to be looking after our residents, and we need to be looking after our houses. But what's the point of doing that if we're not looking after the land?
What was interesting for me watching that footage was the trees weren't burning and the canopy wasn't.
That's right.
Wasn't burning.
That's right. Those are very fire-prone trees, but we burn at the right time and of the year. And to make sure that they are protected, those trees need fire. We live in a country that need fire. And what's happened is that we've stopped evolving with fire. Our fire culture in Australia is totally flawed to nothing. As before, even if you go back 100 years, pastoralists and people who are historically a part of land can tell you themselves. There used to be fires all the time, and even Indigenous people would work in with them and burn country regularly. But we've backed up to a point of regulations, land tenures.
So how often are you going around doing that kind of work?
Full time. I've been doing it for nearly 20 years.
Are you doing it in cooperation with government or agencies? Or are you just doing
it? Not so much. I'm in cooperation with governments and agencies. I mean, agencies are my clients as well. Just recently I had National Parks in New South Wales get me involved in training some of their rangers down there and people as well.
So how do you compare to the average firefighter in Australia, do you think, to someone like John?
Well, for John and, I mean, a lot of guys like John and great blokes. And, it really is about understanding, and they understand, like I said, it's about fighting a fire, or reducing the fuel load. But there's a little more, like for the future of a firefighter like John, in 50 years' time, if we do the right thing, it's going to be someone who knows the soils, who knows all the trees, who knows all the animals when they're breeding. And the other thing is that we need to be burning a lot more regularly. We're not burning enough. And they talk about 90% of Australia that are prone to bushfires. Well, I reckon there's only 10% that actually gets burnt through hazard reductions. Australia is a really big area and a big country. And unfortunately, this government has got to realise that there's a lot of work to do in making sure that we have management teams out there and that we are educating the community and involving the residents and involving communities in understanding fire, not in, a, in its vicious form or its threatening form, but understanding fire in its nurturing and its beautiful way of how beautiful it really is.
John, your reaction to that?
I think we have an enormous amount to learn from Indigenous fire practices, and you know, until now, governments and agencies have burnt for mass and for area. It hasn't been cool burning. It's burned to, you know, to scorch the canopy now, if not cleaned out completely. So there's an enormous amount to learn. Unfortunately, in southern states, in Tasmania and Victoria, a lot of that Indigenous knowledge has been lost. And so we're having to rely on people from outside of those states to come and teach us about these things.
Mm. It sounds so thoroughly sensible.
One of the things that has happened, I guess, over the course of European settlement is the landscape has changed quite considerably. And so Europeans have introduced a whole range of different plants and pasture and that sort of thing. So how applicable some of the traditional practices are in those landscapes, I'm not sure.
How applicable do you think they are, Victor?
100% applicable. It doesn't matter. We still live in Australia. We still have the same climates. We still have the sun beating down on us. The challenge has been in the last 15 years for me was applying actually traditional knowledge into contemporary landscapes.
Could you apply those principles to built up areas like, you know, parts of the city outskirts where there are houses side by side and backyards backing onto the bush?
Yes, I've done that before and I've worked with many of those projects. And of course you need to have rural fires involved and you need to have the community involved when it comes to that point.
How different would people's backyards look looking out onto the bush if it was being managed the way you want to manage it?
Well, the bush would be a lot more clearer from a head height. So if we're able to describe what it would look like, it would be green, it would be clean right through, and there'd be a rich green canopy along the top as well. So the country would look quite beautiful. It doesn't matter how big the fuel load is, and I'll be very bold and I'll say that it doesn't matter how big the fuel load is, we can always protect the canopy. And I've proven that so many times and from as far as North Queensland to Tasmania.
Mm. And why is that so important to protect the canopy?
Well, the canopy is a whole nother world. The canopy is so important to us because that's the life of the flowers, the fruits, the birds, the animals. That's a whole nother place up there that we can't walk up there. Just like we can't walk under water, you know? So that top canopy is very, very sacred. And the simple rule is that it never burns. And if you burn the canopy, then you have the wrong fire. And so teaching how you can burn where fire behaves like water and it trickles through the country and it doesn't burn everything.
Justin, how applicable do you think what Victor's talking about is to the whole of Australia?
Universally. I think that is the perfect explanation of how the bush could be managed on the other side of the interface. And there's so many synergies between, the concept of a fire-adapted community that where someone's back garden enjoys a bit of fire activity.
Do you think people are ready for enjoying a bit of backyard fire activity?
I think it's an evolutionary process. But what they'll realise is their backyard isn't to the back fence. It's this incredible forest that you can once again interact with. And a forest that won't bring problematic fire to the house and threaten it with incredible ferocity.
But that is a cultural shift for a lot of Australians to accept the idea of the backyard.
That's right.
The backyard burn.
And that's what's going to have to happen. There needs to be a cultural shift. We need to evolve our culture with fire.
Well, you don't need to evolve. The rest of us need to evolve.
Yeah, basically, yeah. It's very frustrating. It's very frustrating when I sit at home and I watch the news and I see masses of country just going and it brings a tear to my eye to see that country just being annihilated. And then I go down and I work on that country and have a look at the land and to see all the signs everywhere I go, there's just continuous signs of country just being just totally devastated.
What do you think is getting in the way mostly, or who's getting in the way mostly, of you being able to do the kind of things you're talking about?
Well, it's not hard, I mean, to know that. It really is, you know, the multiple amount of environmental agencies and red tape and attitudes.
that environmentalist attitudes?
Above all, you know, like not just environmentalist attitudes, but
not. Also, I mean, by saying that, that's a big umbrella, but some environmentalist attitudes.
Yeah, some of the attitudes in terms of just accepting Indigenous knowledge for one, and then also just other attitudes of where agencies are more or less just want to do their own fire program so they can cease funding and run their own programs. And so we have all these different people doing different things and delivering different concepts of fire.
Yeah. Why do you think the things Victor's talking about aren't happening in a more widespread way?
For all the reasons that Victor's just mentioned. I mean, we have multiple agencies with control over various bits of the landscape. And you look at any piece of landscape anywhere in Australia, you move from one agency to the next agency to the next agency into private property. Mm.
Justin, do you think there are places that just shouldn't be inhabited in Australia? I mean, what's the message you want to get out around fire?
I'd say that there's a way to live in every part of the landscape, and it's this integrated way of understanding what fire is in that location, how to find the balance and manage the bush in the right way, and that easily unlocks how you build and live and behave and understand.
What are the best things people can do?
They have to start with understanding the land and the landscape. It's this complete connection. I think if they're not willing to buy into the idea of completely becoming part of that location, pick another place.
Tim and Tammy, do you think you understand the landscape around you?
Yes, I think we do. And I think a lot of the things that Victor said, while the Indigenous practice may not have been happening in Denali, I know that when we first moved there in the mid-80s, the last generation of farmers were doing cool burns on a regular basis every year. Yep. And that stopped about 25 years ago, which enabled this big fuel to build up, which caused the destruction that it did.
And that's basically the amount of time it's taken for your statistics to show that there's more bushfires now in the last 15, 20 years. Mm. It all fits in perfectly.
It all fits.
Practice.
Mm. Why did the two of you decide to rebuild on the same block?
The fuel had been burnt, so we're now in a relatively safe place.
Did your daughter, Bonnie, and the grandchildren stay? Because they were living on the property. Did they stay?
They did for the first year or so, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. But no, they chose to take the opportunity to buy a caravan and four-wheel drive and go travelling. So they haven't rebuilt, and they're still waiting to see what they might do.
Well, the kids visited you recently. Mm. Let's go out with them tonight. And thank you all very much for joining us.
I love the water, the space, and just mountain bike tracks nearby. I like that too.
I don't know, I like Denali because it has all my family here, but I don't think I'd like to live here again. I don't know, it's just not the same as it was before.
I do like it here. Mm. I guess I've lived here my whole life and it's kind of fun here.
They're not afraid. They're not... we can go down to the jetty and play and hang out there, and they fish and swim, and there's no issues.
Can you do a nice photo? That's right. Can I have one? Ready? Oh, well, I felt, like, completely shamed.
When you're studying the placebo effect, you have to do that with deception. As a patient, what do you care where the effect comes from? You know, you feel better. That's fine.
Yeah, I can stop it. It was really the power of my mind that stopped it to start with. I should be able to stop it again.